Jay Huger, Jonathan Kim with you to do Rethink Reviews. We're going to review Dirt, the movie, today. Now, John, I have to confess before we watch this that I was a little skeptical. It's like, Dirt? We're going to make Dirt interesting? But you know what? After I watched John's review, I was like, okay, that kind of grabbed my attention. I'd like to know a little bit more about it. So let's watch the review and come back and tell you some fun facts.
When humans arrived 2 million years ago, everything changed for Dirt. And from that moment on, the fate of Dirt and humans has been intimately linked.
We think that diamonds are very important, gold is very important, all these minerals are very important. We call them precious minerals. But they are all forms of the soil. But that part of this mineral that is on top, like it is the skin of the earth, that is the most precious of the commons.
Our wealth is imaginary. It comes from soil.
If we don't take care of the soil, which is just the first 5 centimeters layer of life that is on the earth, our future is totally condemned.
When we think about pollution and damage to the environment, we tend to think about air, water, and what's happening above ground. You can see waste being dumped into our rivers, the smog staining the air above our cities, or trees being cut down. But rarely do we think of the pollution and destruction of the land itself, the literal dirt beneath our feet. Maybe it's because all dirt pretty much looks the same, or because it's hard to think of dirt, that stuff we try to rid from our houses, clothes, and bodies, as a living thing that needs our protection. But that's exactly what the documentary Dirt the Movie is here to tell you, that dirt is alive, and that mankind's connection to dirt and its health is possibly the most important relationship humans have ever had.
Humans' interest in dirt isn't anything new. The film points out that the creation myths of nearly every religion have the first humans springing from the soil or being fashioned from dirt by a deity. Humans belonged to the earth, not the other way around, and we learned to live off the gifts it provided. Then agriculture came along, making our relationship with dirt even more intimate as we started to control the earth and the water to raise our own plants and animals. This led to humans creating permanent settlements, often and still making our homes out of, you guessed it, dirt. Eventually, science confirmed what our culture had already told us, that dirt is, in fact, alive, with billions of organisms living in every spoonful that break down organic matter and return nutrients to the soil. Dirt is also integral to cleaning the world's fresh water, and healthy soil grows plants and trees that prevent erosion, feed animals, clean the air, consume carbon, and store water. As far as we know, the Earth is the only planet covered by this thin layer of living skin between rock and the air. And without this skin, life as we know it would not exist. But as with all living things, soil is fragile, and Dirt the Movie reveals the many ways humans are destroying this underappreciated wealth. The modern agricultural system has become a Frankenstein's monster, where decades of monoculture farming has stripped the soil of its nutrients, requiring tons of synthetic fertilizers so any crops can grow at all. Monoculture farming also increases the use of pesticides, which not only kills pests, but also the beneficial organisms that live in the soil. The unabsorbed fertilizers and pesticides eventually run off into the water supply, harming the ecology of our oceans and rivers. Short-sighted agricultural techniques also lead to deforestation, which increases erosion, extinctions, drought, and further contributes to climate change. Big agribusiness also pushes out small farmers, the people who have tended and relied on the soil for generations. Then there's the effects of resource extraction on the soil. Millions of acres of forest are clear-cut every year for timber, disrupting the soil's natural cycles. And, of course, there's the horrific damage done through mining, the worst examples of which are the rapacious techniques of strip mining and mountaintop removal, where millions of tons of earth are blown up to get at the minerals inside, with the dirt trucked away and dumped like trash, leaving enormous craters and scars across the landscape where plants can no longer grow. The film also draws a connection between environmental degradation and conflict, where violence, instability, and desperation are found wherever people lack healthy soil and clean water for farming. But now that we understand the science and importance of healthy soil, we can do more to help it. We can diversify our crops, make more of our farmland organic, and mimic natural processes like composting that we know contribute to healthy soil. We can stop clear-cutting the world's forests and blowing up our mountains, which causes erosion, the loss of valuable topsoil, and the desertification of productive land. We can peel away some of the pavement in our communities to let the earth breathe, grow plants, absorb and clean our water, and reduce dangerous runoff. And most importantly, we can give people the chance to renew their relationship with the land so they can understand the many benefits, including therapeutic ones, of green spaces and getting our hands dirty. As the writer Wendell Berry said, our land passes in and out of our bodies, just as our bodies pass in and out of our land. If we keep disrespecting the connection between our dirt and our lives, we run the risk that someday our dirt, our earth, may not want us here anymore. I'm Jonathan Kim, and this is a Rethink Review.
John, I'll tell you what, I was most fascinated by the idea of dirt being kind of the skin of the earth. That's interesting. So how many centimeters of dirt are there all around the world?
For the most part, the numbers I've heard were between 2 inches to about 3 feet. Uh-huh. But it's really, it's a small layer because below that, the dirt starts to get a lot more compacted. And so roots can't really grow in them. So it's really only the first maybe 2 to 8 inches-ish. That's where almost all of the, where all the nutrients come from that plants grow from. A lot of people don't know this, but for most plants, the roots go out more sideways than they do go down. So mm-hmm. they can collect water closer to the surface. But that's sort of like where most of the action is going. It's like the soil is sort of like, it's kind of like where the digestion of organic matter sort of happens, where other animals and plants can get to it.
All right, that's interesting. But John, as I'm watching that, I'm thinking, yeah, but we've improved farming and our output and our production dramatically in modern history. So, I mean, there's a tremendous upside to that kind of larger scale manufacturing of farming, if you will.
A little bit. See, the reason why we've been able to increase our output so much is through mechanization. That's a big thing, but mostly through nitrogen-based fertilizers. Uh-huh. And so when you have these, we kind of talked about this with Food Inc. and with King Corn, if you have, you know, millions of acres of, and you're only growing one crop, you're stripping the nutrients out of the ground at a huge rate. And then also you're spraying pesticides everywhere, which kills the organisms in the soil. So the soil is basically dead. So the plants are getting all of their nutrients from the fertilizers. The dirt essentially becomes a plant holder, but not something that actually feeds the plant. And then also, if you're growing the same thing over and over and over again, and you're not planting what's called cover crops, or you're not rotating your crops, then you'll strip all the nutrients out of the ground.
But, you know, of course, that puts you in a situation where you have to keep buying those fertilizers from those companies. I said, I get that. But at the same time, it still works.
The thing is, it's actually, if a hand-tended small plot of land that has a diverse bunch of plants growing in it is actually more productive than an acre of factory-farmed plants. Because if you see those,
right, but it's so much harder to farm that way, so that it becomes less efficient.
Well, it's harder for grocery stores. I mean, like the big grocery store chains, because they want everything to be uniform. They want everything to be exactly the same, and they want stuff that's going to be able to ship farther, things like that. Not necessarily things that are good, but when you look at what the small farmers used to do, which are basically gone in America and most parts of the world, they were the ones who lived on the soil and tended the soil, and they usually had animals. They were putting manure back into the soil. They were rotating their crops. So they were actually good for the soil, increasing its health and increasing topsoil. But that's one thing. When you have this big factory farming, you leave tons of soil bare for parts of the year a lot of times, and it simply blows away. There we lose 25 billion tons of topsoil every year. About 1% of our soil we just lose to erosion, and it takes about 100 years to create an inch of healthy soil.
I mean, by that logic, in 100 years or less we're gonna have no soil left.
It could be. Or, I mean, we can change our farming techniques. They talk about no tilling, where you don't till the land, and that means you leave like the stubble of the plants, you leave that there. But also, I mean, when you look at the way that we farm now, where we're cutting down rainforests and things like that, I mean, a lot of human history has been moving on to arable land. But what they do, so like they'll cut down a forest, they'll burn everything, which also hurts the soil. They'll grow stuff for a little while using these really kind of nutrient-heavy techniques. Eventually the soil dies, and then people just move on, but what they leave is essentially a desert where nothing's going to grow anymore. So we need to find ways to mimic what nature does better instead of trying to do this hardcore technological industrial way of doing it.
Right. Now wait, how much of the forest do they replant though? I mean, if you want to make money and you burn down all the forests, I mean, maybe in the short run they're going to make the money anyway and they don't care. That's entirely possible. But aren't they executives that do the farming that would care about the soil and, you know, using the wood that then need more wood later? Aren't they taking this into consideration?
I think a lot of times they don't. obviously, if it's a corporation doing the farming, they just want the short term. Another thing is you have these very hungry people, kind of like people who become nomadic because they've had to leave their land that used to grow stuff but doesn't grow stuff anymore. And so they're just going and they're getting whatever they can. So they're cutting down forests, burning them, planting stuff for a little while, and then just moving on. So there isn't as much soil management as there possibly could be. And that was the problem during the Dust Bowl.
I wanted to ask you about the Dust Bowl. How did that come about?
So the Dust Bowl, I didn't really know that much about this. It was between about 1930 to 1940, and it was in the Great Plains area, which used to be just kind of grassland and wasn't considered very good for farming. But then there were several years when it was very wet. They had several wet years, and Americans at that time were like, "Oh, so I guess it's going to be fine. Like, let's go and farm the Great Plains." So they went and started farming it. But the problem was that they weren't doing crop rotation. They weren't letting the soil repair itself. And then when the dry years and the drought kicked back in, basically no one was able to grow anything. They had also been a lot of overgrazing, which killed all the grass that anchors the soil down. As the soil gets drier, it becomes more dusty. And then there were these windstorms that came about and basically just blew the soil basically into the Atlantic Ocean. And all those people had to leave and go to, you know, a lot of them went to California. Those were the Okies. Not having plants there contributed to the droughts because plants, they suck up water and then it evaporates very slowly through their leaves. And that keeps moisture in that area. But without that, and with the winds being able to just howl across with no trees to break it, then it was a
disaster. What I'm hearing from you is the individual farmers back then blew it. And when corporate America took over, we were back to producing a lot of great farming.
Well, I think they've understood a little bit better now how to work it, and they actually started sort of like a soil conservation program, and we're teaching people about, you know, how to prevent erosion, but we're still not doing it at the amounts we want to, and what we're doing, the way that we're farming now, in the end, it's simply not sustainable, and it's actually incredibly unhealthy for everybody involved.
All right, and one more quick thing, mountaintop removal. That you can't be against that, because that's a lot of fun, and it looks really pretty, so what kind of damage does that do?
Well, in what I found in West Virginia and Kentucky is where they do the most mountaintop removal. Each state is using approximately 1,000 tons of explosives a day to blow off.
That's cool.
So we're blowing off the tops of these mountains basically to get at the coal underneath, and basically we're leaving bare land, which if it rains, all of a sudden that stuff just floods down into the rivers. It kills the rivers. All the debris that they blow off the tops of the mountains, they pile into valleys and often cover up streams. They've covered up hundreds of miles of streams. But
what did God make valleys for other than to dump our toxic, mountaintop that were removed?
Exactly.
Like, this guy doesn't know anything about Massey Energy. It's weird.
Well, it's one of those things where they talk about how coal is cheaper and they're talking about clean coal. But, I mean, for one, to get at the coal is incredibly expensive. To process the coal, it leaves sludge, which, I mean, I think last year or the year before, a coal sludge reservoir busted and buried a town.
They had it coming.
Yeah, exactly.
What were they doing in the path of a perfectly profitable coal sludge?
But see, the big thing, like the coal companies say, oh, well, it's cheaper for us to blow up the tops of these mountains, and we don't need to use as many miners. So it's actually safer. But so first of all, it costs jobs to remove mountaintops. We only 5% of U.S. coal comes from mountaintops, so not really that much. But then I think the bigger question that we need to ask is, how much is a mountain worth? Mm-hmm. Who owns it? You know, like, does someone have a right to buy it and destroy it?
$275. That's my going price. All right. There's a lot of interesting issues here. So my summary here is, well, some ups and downs here. I mean, John brings up a lot of good points about the downs. On the other hand, I know that we've helped alleviate hunger in the world through this, large-scale farming. So I'm not totally buying what you're selling this week.
Okay. Well,
all right.
I'll work on it.
But it's a fun little slight disagreement here. But if you want to check out more, of course, Rethink Reviews on Huffington Post, on YouTube, and RethinkReviews.net.
Oh, yeah, also, and DirtTheMovie.org is the website, and I think they're trying to have people organize sort of community viewings of it, so check that out.
Yeah, check it out, and I took home some dirt earlier today. I scooped it up, brought it home. After seeing the review, I was inspired. So, wait, I should be putting it on the farm. I'm screwing this whole thing up.